That was a great surprise to me. It was not me who said that I was classified 1Y the last time or whatever it was. It was them, it was the government who tested me. It was the government who said that I'm not able. All of a sudden, they seemed to be anxious to push me into the Army and throw me in the 1A category out of 30 or 40 men that they could have picked from, and two men made the decision. And another thing I don't understand, I really don't understand, is why me, a man who pays the salary of at least 50,000 men in Vietnam, a man who the government takes $6 million from a year out in two fights, a man who can pay in two fights for three bomber planes, why would you take and seek out and be anxious to call me out of 30 men who you could have called? And I just don't understand yet how I can be reclassified as 1A without testing me in no way, just calling me like this, and I just don't understand it.
When I'm expected to go overseas to help free the people in South Vietnam, and at the same time, my people here in Kentucky are being brutalized and mistreated, and this has really disturbed me more so than what's happening in Vietnam.
Let's quit worrying white people, plaguing white people's neighborhood, forcing ourselves on white people, and we don't clean up and do for ourselves. The slum is not in the neighborhood. The slum is not in the ghetto. The slum is in the people. The people make the slum. And the condition our people are in now, if you gave them a $93 million project, they'll make a slum out of it in 24 hours. Then you can take a nation of people who are intelligent, and they can make a slum a paradise.
But like today, this thing just came up where I'm reclassified at 1A. And I just can't understand how they could reclassify me as 1A when they were the ones who said, the government officials were the ones who said that I was 1Y and that I wasn't qualified. It was their decision. Now, all of a sudden, I'm 1A without any test, without notifying me or checking to see if I'm any wiser than I was the last time or any worse.
If you're drafted, will you fight for your country?
Well, I'm not saying nothing about things that I don't have to say. I don't have to say nothing about that. They haven't drafted me yet, and it's a touchy thing, touchy question, and I'd rather not say nothing.
I'm not here to apologize in the way that the press has projected that I would apologize.
What about your unpatriotic remarks that you made?
That will be straightened out with the government or whoever I have to face when it comes to that.
Are you apologizing for having made those statements at this time?
That'll be taken up with the government.
If I recall correctly, you said you were the people's champion?
Yes, sir.
Do you think that you're acting like a people's champion?
Yes, sir.
Labeling my fighters. You know, a rabbit is an animal that's scared of his own shadow. A rabbit is an animal that if you pin him in a corner, he'll freeze and he won't be able to move. That's why I call Patterson the rabbit, because he has the characteristic of a rabbit. Sonny Liston looked at him hard and he froze in both fights, just like a rabbit. And Chevaldo's the washwoman. You know how women fight. They have a wild style, lady style of fighting. That's the way he fights. So he's the washwoman. So whenever you hear me say the washwoman or the rabbit, you know that's Patterson or Chevaldo.
And of course you call Liston the bear.
Yeah, the bear, he's in hibernation. This will be a mismatch. Floyd Patterson will be no match. He's too short. He's too slow. He don't have the reach. He can't take a punch. He don't hit hard. And he don't have the footwork. This will be a mismatch. I will hit him about six times to every miss.
Why don't you call me my name, man?
Well, what's your name? You told me your name was Cassius Clay.
I never told you my name was Cassius Clay.
Well,
my name is Muhammad Ali. And you will announce it right there in the center of that ring after the fight if you don't do it now.
For the benefit of this broadcast, him, all right?
You just acting just like an old Uncle Tom. A mother fly cop. I'm going to punish you.
Let me tell you something, man. You ain't got no...
Back off of me. Back off of me.
Don't call me no Uncle Tom.
That's what you are, an Uncle Tom.
Why are you going to call me Uncle Tom?
What you going to... You heard me? Back off of me.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the two contestants prepare for battle right now...
Back off of me, man. Back off of me, man.
Another interview has been recorded for posterity. And the two gentlemen continue...
Uncle Tom!
Perfect.
A lot of people have asked about that interview we did together with Terrell, Coast to Coast, a week or so ago, where you and Terrell almost came to blows. And many people have said it was a publicity stunt, that you staged it.
They have a right to believe so, Howard, because many things in the past that I have done was publicity stunts. That's all. But this time it was serious. And I almost struck him. I did hit him on the hand. I intended to...
Oh, do you hate him?
No, I don't really hate him, but I don't really hate no one, but I don't like him for his actions and the way he was acting and insisting on calling me Cassius Clay, knowing that my name is Muhammad Ali. And I'm a Muslim, and whenever this is discussed as serious, I don't play with the religion, the name. So he really made me, and that was not play. That was real.
He's going around claiming to be the real heavyweight champ. But after I'm finished, he'll just be a friend. Now, I'm not saying this just to be funny, but I'm fighting Ernie because he needs the money.
You taking Zora Foley too lightly?
Why would you say that?
Because every indication has been that you're confident that you can beat Zara.
I'm confident I can whoop all of them. This ain't nothing new. My image is being confident. What you trying to make it look like something new for? I'm always confident I can whoop all of them.
You're being extremely truculent.
Whatever truculent mean, if that's good, I'm that.
Right now, the number one fight is Zora Foley. And after I finish Zora Foley, then we'll cross the other bridge as far as the draft is concerned when we get to it. But I have a very strange feeling if this thing do go through as far as the induction is concerned, appeals or what have you are turned down. As a matter of fact, I know this is my last fight.
I couldn't see myself taking part in nothing where I would help and aid in any way to shooting and killing these Asiatic dark black people who haven't caught me nigger, haven't lynched me, they haven't deprived me of freedom, justice, and equality, they haven't assassinated my leaders. I couldn't see myself shooting little black babies and black children that don't even have food to eat.
This picture right here describes me in the court. It shows the white judge with an evil face. It has the jury over here. 12 whites with all evil faces, so all the jury were looking angry, and the judge was looking mad, and here we was just a matter of time and going through the court procedures, but I knew where I was headed, and before that, I had drawn a picture up here, a little cartoon with me thinking, showing over my head, and you see a jail, which is where they finally sent me to.
Will you go into service?
This would be 1,000% against the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the religion of Islam, and the Holy Quran, the holy book that we believe in. This will all be denouncing and defying everything that I stand for.
This would mean, of course, that you stand the chance of going to jail as a result of not going into service.
Well, whatever the punishment, whatever the persecution is for standing up for my religious beliefs, even if it means facing machine gun fire that day, I will face it before denouncing Elijah Muhammad and the religion of Islam. I'm ready to die.
As many of you know, these days I'm not boxing. So I accept these college invitations to come out to meet many of you. I realize that in these country towns like this, you never get a chance to see the world champs.
Now, draft is another thing that's against my religious beliefs.
I said that I'm going to be a man. I'm going to fight it legally. If I lose it, I'm just going to jail. I'm not burning no draft cards. I still have it. I'm not laying on the Pentagon steps. I'm not hanging statues of Lyndon Johnson. I'm not burning American flags. I'm only following the law.
I've turned down $8 million in movies, commercials, advertisements, endorsements before draft ever came up because of my religious beliefs.
We worked 310 years and ain't got nothing. At least you worked 100 years and got something. And we fought in all the wars. And we still fighting in them. And still a nigga.
What you mean if I believe in separation? I've recognized the fact that you believe in it. That's what your people believe in. What you mean you don't believe in it? No, you just talking crazy. Every city I go to, I can find a black neighborhood and a white neighborhood. What you mean you don't believe in it? How many Negroes live out here just in this big old neighborhood? You can't blame a black man for wanting to leave all this mistreatment. You must be crazy. So what you mean don't take white money? Only thing white about that money is the white pictures on it. What you mean white money? If that's the case, I should take off these clothes. You made them too. I shouldn't fly in your airplane. What am I going to do? Just go out and lay down somewhere and hide in the mud hole?
He wanted to know after the whole draft business is over, whether I'm in jail or not, will I come back to fight? Well, you don't know. I heard they start cleaning out my cell because they look for me to be on the trail to jail without bail.
Been brainwashed, and it's time for him to learn something about himself. When he look at television, he see white owl cigars, white swan soap, king white soap, white rain hair rinse, white tornado flow wax, white plus toothpaste. They taught him when he was a little boy that Mary had a little lamb, his feet as white as snow. Then they taught him about Snow White. Then there's the White House. Everything bad is black. So he's been brainwashed. So now he needs to be taught something about himself so he can be proud and quit worrying you and pushing you out of your neighborhoods, quit running your daughter, and quit chasing you out of your schools. And every day you got a headache with this Negro that has been brainwashed by your kind. So now it's our job to re-brainwash him, to teach him that rich dirt is black dirt. Don't feel bad. Strong coffee is black coffee. You understand? You make it weepy integrated. You understand? So now he feels proud. Now he's not begging no more. Now he wants to be himself. He's not worrying you no more. So he needs some black history, and he needs some black culture, so he'll know who he is and be proud to be who he is and quit worrying you so much.
Any white woman in this audience today, any white man in this audience today, in their right minds, don't want little black boys and little black, white, black girls coming around your homes, schools, and churches looking to marry your sons and daughters and in return introducing your grandchildren as little half-brown, kinky-haired Negro children. All right. Not seeking to lose our identity in blood mixing and our beautiful black African history. We don't hate you. We don't hate those of you who are white. We just want to stay black. We love my color. I just love myself.
And no nation, no people can be free without land. And we are a whole nation, 22 million people without a toothpick factory.
So you can't now be angry because they tired and they don't see no more hope in integrating. Integrating and fail, swimming in the fail, laying in, walking in, still getting the heads beat in, and you wonder now why they tired.
I'm not going to help nobody get something my Negroes don't have. If I'm going to die, I'll die now, right here fighting you. If I'm going to die, you my enemy. My enemy is the white people, not Viet Cong or Chinese or Japanese. You my opposer when I want freedom. You my opposer when I want justice. You my opposer when I want equality. You won't even stand up for me in America for my religious beliefs, and you want me to go somewhere and fight, but you won't even stand up for me here at home. You won't stand up for what I believe now.
You
white race attacks the black people. You don't ask us what's our religion or what's our belief. You just start whooping black heads. They don't say, are you a Catholic, are you a Baptist, are you a black Muslim, are you a Catholic, you a Martin Luther King follower, are you a Whitney Young? They just go,
we were named after our slave masters when we first was brought to America. We were robbed of all knowledge of ourselves. If I said, here comes Mr. Chain Chong, you'd picture a Chinaman. If I said, here comes Mr. Khrushchev, you look for Russian. If I said, here comes Mr. Goldberg, you look for Jew. If I said, here comes Mr. White Cloud, you look for Indian. If I said, here comes Mr. Castro, you look for Cuban. Here comes Mr. Lumumba, Mr. Kenyatta, you look for African, a black man. Now, what's your last name? So I said, here comes Mr. Jones, Mr. Hawkins, Mr. Clay, Mr. Culpepper, Mr. Roundtree. You won't know if he's black or white until you see him. Have been brainwashed. Everything good and of authority was made white. We look at Jesus, we see a white with blonde hair and blue eyes. We look at all the angels, we see white with blonde hair and blue eyes.
Heaven.
Now, I'm sure if there's a heaven in the sky and the color folks die and go to heaven, where are the colored angels? They must be in the kitchen preparing the milk and honey. We look at Miss America, we see white. We look at Miss World, we see white. We look at Miss Universe, we see white.
Even Tarzan, the king of the jungle in back Africa. He's right.
We were taught when we were little children that Mary had a little lamb, his feet as white as snow. Then we were taught about Snow White. This is not funny, this is serious. This is a fact, true fact.
White owl cigar. White swan soap. King white soap. White cloud tissue paper. White rain hair rinse. White tornado floor wax. White plus toothpaste. All the good cowboys ride the white horses. The White House. Angel food cake is the white cake, but the devil food cake is the chocolate cake.
Why are we called Negroes? Why are we deaf, dumb, and blind? Why is everybody making progress, and yet we lag so far behind? Why are we mistreated? Why are we in this condition, stripped of our name, our language, our culture, our God, and our religion? Here in America, all of our religious training has been gotten by the preacher. He has told us of a heaven way up in the sky that we can't enjoy now, but rather after we die. But all of the years that we are living, for us there's nothing but hell, pain, torture, and misgiving. Yet the Bible speaks of a heaven filled with material luxuries, which the white man and the preachers have right here, so we see. So my friends, take it for what it is worth. Your heaven and your hell is right here on this earth.
Can my title be taken without me being whooped?
No!
One more time.
No!
That's all I can do.
Our leader, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, teaches us, I don't care how much you march on Washington, I don't care how much you wear some afros and some African robes, I don't care what you do, if we don't have a program to teach us to respect and protect our women, you'll never be nothing, because the woman is the field which produces your nation. White man comes in your neighborhood every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. He don't even need no guards. He know you ain't gonna do nothing. Come by himself, looking for your women. Take your sisters to the motels. Take your wives and your mamas and your daughters. I see it. I've traveled from coast to coast every day. You around here hollering freedom and black power, and the white man carrying your woman to the motel in your neighborhood. You watch him check in, and you don't even protest. You don't even kick the door or nothing. You don't even throw a rock at the car. If you're scared, kick the door and run. Do something. Everybody respects and protects their women, but so-called Negroes. Some of y'all ain't worked a day in your life. Got your hair all conked down, shoes all turned up on the corner. How about, nigga, I'm pimping. You pimpin', all right. You a sissy. That's what you are.
So will our next mystery challenger enter and sign in, please.
And I want to tell you, in those days, the scale money was important to Ali and the guy. That's where we got him on the show, to get him some money. He needed the money. He didn't have any money.
I can introduce him simply by saying he is one of the most honest individuals I have ever met in my life. Ladies and gentlemen, the heavyweight champion of the world, to me, Muhammad Ali. I'd like for you to tell the what is the basis behind this teaching and this belief.
We believe that since we are 22 to 30 million people, and work 310 long years, 16 hours a day for nothing, to enable America to be the 50 of the richest states on the planet, and fought in the Japanese War, the German War, the Korean, now down in Vietnam, to uphold America's freedom and independence. We think now that the master should now say, slave, you helped me build the house and you done worked so hard and tried to love me, but I wouldn't accept you. I shot your leaders and killed you. Now that you are free and educated now, here, take a few of these states, go back to Asia and Africa now that you're educated, and build a government for yourself, and give us a good send-off, and we think this is the solution.
You are a wise man, you're an intelligent man, and if I was not a Muslim or follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I couldn't talk to you for 2 minutes. And I believe I can hold my own as an intelligent conversation with you. But it all comes from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But people praise me. Oh, you should be the leader. Well, you don't have to follow Elijah. Man, are you a fool? Everything I got come from him. He taught me who I was. He made me proud. He made me fearless. He made me love my own. I've turned down millions and to keep from selling out my people. The beautiful name Muhammad Ali. I now have 56 Muslim invitations by governments. All they ask me about when I go to those countries, how is Elijah Muhammad?
You believe something which I happen to know isn't true.
Now hold it. See, what is it that I believe?
You believe
it's not true.
You believe that the entire white community is your enemy. I happen to know it's not your enemy. I doubt if there's anybody in this room who is your enemy.
I'll tell
enemy.
You what.
But I do believe that just as Hitler persuaded all the Germans to believe that all of the Jews were their enemy, that the people are engaged in spreading this kind of virulence, and that some very, very sincere people get caught up in it. You're an example of it.
22 million black people in America. Who would you say our everyday common enemy is? What other country or what nationality? I mean, you know, you have the nerve to be on a TV show like this and look at me like I'm wrong for saying Elijah Muhammad is poisoning you by telling you that we're your enemies. Yeah. And I feel it and see it every day. And every black man watching this show know you are enemies. And you have the nerve to stand up here and say Elijah Muhammad is poisoning my mind. He cannot teach us that you are enemy. You taught us. And your people daily, Martin Luther King is bumped off unjustly. Adam Clayton Powell was bumped off unjustly. They took my title unjustly. They killed Mega Zev unjustly. All the integrators who love white folks was unjustly kicked out of Washington. They've been deprived of education and poverty throughout the country.
Will you welcome, please, Muhammad Ali.
I'm not allowed to earn a living here. I'm not allowed to leave the country. I have about $10 million in contracts in foreign countries, European and African countries, and the government has taken my passport so that I can't go out here to work. Then I cannot work in America. So, and I have, I can name many more people,
but,
you know.
But you can't say, though, can you, Muhammad, the simple thing that one race is righteous and another isn't. We all
well,
have
I'm, not, I'm not going into that, you know, I just said...
No, but you I mean, all I was, all I meant was I can't leave you saying that, in the sense you can't say that one race...
Well, I would say that the weapons, all of your guns and your bombs and your poisons are created by your white race.
You can't say that, though, Muhammad. We all
whiskey.
Have faults.
I would say whiskey and homosexuality. If you go back to England, your country, Europe, when they kicked out the old...
Packed with whiskey and homosexuality wherever you
look.
You
remember
certainly.
When the old... A lot of the whites were kicked out of there. They say there's trash, they say, so-called.
No, but,
they,
but I mean...
They're the ones that landed here.
You can say certain... you can say that there are certain things that... for instance, come and stem from
I'll
white people. On the other hand, the black race is equally. We all have our faults.
Well,
you
I
know,
would say this.
I mean, cannibalism, where does that come from?
I would say this.
I don't know
about cannibalism. All I know is what you told me in history about it. See, now, I don't say I hate you now. Huh? Don't say that. I know now. Well, I was going through Mississippi on a college tour not long ago. Stopped at the filling station. Have a long limousine. You know, I pulled through and I traveled in it because a lot of times I don't like to fly. And the fella came out. He said, "What must I give you, boy?" And had a fella with me. He said, "Boy." I said, "Shut your mouth." Restroom? "Well, I don't think it's working." I said, "Thank you, sir." I'm the guy gonna stand up. I'm the champ of the whole world. You want me to fight for America and I can't even use the toilet. You want me to, what you talking, I wasn't gonna do that, see? I had a right to say I'm the Olympic gold medal winner. I'm Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay. And he's mad. He called the highway patrol, and a Klansman might be around. I'm way back in there by myself, and I can't box that good. You understand? To avoid that booby trap, I said, shut your mouth. We'll go down the highway and find a place we can go. We went a little farther, and we were welcomed in another one. So what I'm trying to say is, I know where to go and where not to go.
Boxing promoters around the country have had endless difficulty trying to arrange a fight for Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali. But book publishers at Random House had no difficulty today getting 9 camera crews and about 100 reporters and photographers to a news conference to announce his autobiography.
I have many, many things that I would like to say, I would like to talk about concerning the draft situation, concerning the boxing authorities and the steps that have been taken unjustly to not allow me to earn a living, things and reasons what have motivated me to become a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I'm going to tell it all just like it is, and I just can't wait to get started on this book.
Seed $200,000 for his book.
Thank you very much.
I wish you well.
Thank you very much. Writing is as good as fighting.
Say hi.
Miriam?
Say hi.
Give me milk. Give me some more milk. Give me some more milk. Give me some. Anyway, so he's I'm not having no trouble out of you. There ain't but one big mouth in this family. There ain't gonna be but one big mouth in this family.
My intention is to box to win a clean fight. But in war, the intention is to kill, 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 and continue killing innocent people. That's what the business is in war.
Even if the wealth of America was given to me for taking the step, the wealth of America and the friendship of all of the people who support the war, this will still be nothing if I am not content internally and if I'm not in part with the will of Almighty Allah.
It has been said that I have two alternatives, either go to jail or go to the army. But I would like to say that there is another alternative, and that alternative is justice.
Now, I would like to hear this from you. I would like to hear this from you. And I want the world and the cameras to hear. Who's the heavyweight champion of the world? One more time, we don't want no excuses. They may say the film was bad or the camera was broke. One more time, who's the champion of the world?
Oh, I was on 79th Street on the south side and just bought me orange in a grocery store, and the grocery owner came out and grabbed me and hugged me with tears in his eyes, little black fella, and told me that you've just been vindicated and you three, 8 judges all voted in your favor, and he just hugged me and squeezed me, and he was this short, heavy set fella.